our sports teams and that we don't have ice hockey, we don't have that, that it's more reassurance that, hey, we can go back to school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And try to transition into
almost
that.
Almost a testing of some of our protocols.
And we've done it successfully so far, Amy, with the athletics, you know, in those smaller cohorts. We've done it with the arts programs, and, you know, we have been training and doing events with our staff now that have some decent numbers. But again, everything seems to take longer, and there's much more steps to it. I think where the challenge lies is when that number goes from 20 to, again, that 400 or 500.
Regular August meeting. Mr. Moore, will you call the roll, please?
Yes, sir. Board Chair Stephen Scribner.
Here.
Vice Chair Denise Adams.
Here.
Amy Day.
Here.
Deborah Hood.
Here.
And Bobby Welch.
Here.
We have five present. We have a quorum.
Thank you. Do we have anyone leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance this evening, or are we just going to roll with it?
Let's just roll with it.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Jessamine County Schools exist to motivate and challenge every child every day to be a caring, responsible citizen and a high-level thinker, performer, communicator, and learner for life. Let us all remember that's what guides our decisions this evening. The approval of the agenda this evening, I'd like to recommend we add one item under the action items, section G, and that is to consider the superintendent's plan and recommendations for athletics for the 2021 school year. Do we have a motion?
Second.
Okay, motion to adopt the agenda with a revision from Bobby. Second was Amy. All those in favor say aye. Say no. Okay. Board meeting minutes from the July 27th and August 3rd meetings. We've all had a chance to look those over. Are there any revisions we need to make? Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the July 27th meeting minutes. Okay. Denise seconds. All those in favor say aye. Opposed, say no. All right, I'll make a motion to approve the August 3rd special board meeting minutes. Say aye. Aye. Opposed, say no. All right. Construction update, Mr. Moore.
We have three different architects that are going to be sharing a short presentation with you guys this evening. And I just wanted to remind you guys that this is for our Rosenwald, Dunbar, as well as West Middle renovations. And we had five different architects bid for this or communicate to us that they were interested in working with us, and our committee screened the initial five and have identified the three that we're recommending that you listen to this evening. So Jason has coordinated them, so if you would like to do some introductions, I'd appreciate it, Jason.
Yep, so I'm going to go ahead and introduce our first architect firm. It's Alt 32 Cox. This is Lindsay Jordan and Mike Sparkman. I told them to keep their presentation under 30 minutes each. They're going to go ahead and present first. If you guys have any questions for them, please feel free to ask. And I'll just be sitting over here.
But you're all. Well, thank you, Jay. I'm going to try to find a comfortable place to set for this.
Mr. Sparkman, if you're going to stay by the podium, feel free to remove your mask just so we can understand you a little bit
okay.
Better.
Is that okay?
Oh, yeah, that's fine. Yeah, just.
Excellent.
We try to, if we're spread out here enough, we try to keep our masks off so we can
sure.
Hear each other.
No, you're good. set up for Q&A, but if there's time for Q&A, let us know. I'm going to lead off with that. And Lindsay, I think you have a few notes to share.
Yeah, I just kind of want to start by saying thank you for having us. We are extremely interested in these projects. New schools, renovations, space planning, these are all things that we've basically been focusing on for the 31 years our firm has been in business. We've performed over 2,200 education-related projects in our history. So it's fair to say that education projects are in our blood. And we're very excited about them.
Yeah. So the book that we provided tried to show a spectrum of the things that we can do. We know when you hire an architect, you're asking for a person, a firm, to do a whole lot of things. So anything from
The fact that we can cover all these bases, I think, is a plus. We're not just strong in one category, though I would say we have done a very, very many renovations. There's a lot more opportunities to do renovations in new construction, so we've kind of cut our teeth on that. So when you look at these projects, we try to tailor this around the project that you presented, Rosenwald Dunbar. So we've done very large HVAC renovations, specifically with the state government, DECA. And recently we did one to the Ashland Community and Technical College and it went really well. We had a very good engineer on that project that helps. So what we do when we select our team, it's very important as well. And you'll see the engineers that we put in this book are very well crafted, I think, for your project. The other thing that we noticed when we walked through on the 18th is that as we listened to the school principal, space planning and the use of those spaces was really important. So what we tried to do here with this Walden project, I think this one wasn't in the book, but with this project specifically in Louisville, Kentucky, they had to look at their campus, their master plan of their entire campus, and we had to think about the inside spaces versus the outside spaces, the playground space, the athletic fields, and things like that. So we think that has some relevance. We're not coming to you tonight with any specific design solutions. We're not coming to you and saying that, oh, this is what we would propose. Lindsay is going to get into some of the notes that we made at the meeting or the walkthrough, and that'll kind of give more of a narrative. And then some of the other projects, specifically a cafeteria kitchen renovation for Warren East High School, very proud of that project. It involved how we worked on the outside of the building versus the inside. And we think that's something of critical importance these days, especially with the way that schools have to deal with security. There's much more, regulations put on that. And at times we find this can be a conflict with the architecture. So we like to approach the school, approach the district, and find out the best way to handle that, because some of the things we like to see in buildings are kind of difficult to do today. I think another project that we did recently that I think met with a lot of success was the renovation to Jenkins Independent Middle High School. We had to approach that school and put in new security vestibules. And the district was very patient, very welcoming of this. It was a new thing for them. And we used card readers and key fobs as the entrance access system. They loved it. And it's actually, the technology's been around quite a while. But, each district looks at it differently, and they evaluate their needs. So we'd come to you with those suggestions as well. Lindsay, would you want to pick up? Yeah.
Makes sense. Okay, so you'll see this in our submission proposal. This is kind of something we put together after getting the floor plan from Jason and walking through the school on the 18th. Like Mike said, we don't want to propose design solutions yet because there's plenty of meetings to be done with everyone involved at the school, the board, yourselves. You can't quite get everything that you want to be done to a school within, an hour-long meeting. We want to talk more about design solutions and what's most important, the highest priority. So, as you'll see in the purple, we kind of saw that as the highest priority. That may change, but that's kind of the idea that we got while we were there. One of the biggest things is this vestibule here for the car entrance, the main entrance of the school. That's not a secure entrance, and I know that that was a big thing for the administration, is that there's no sight lines here from the administration office, and it also directly enters the admin office as well as the media center. And they also, I think, there's a lot of space planning issues here. They said that they have a lot of psychologists that come in the school during the day. There's not really room to house those psychologists and counselors to talk to the children during the day. So they need some meeting space for that. They also mentioned that the Family Resource Center was very important to this school, and they have this very small space here to assist those children as well. So that's a space planning issue they have here. Another thing they mentioned is that this is the only working adult bathroom in the entire school. So that's sure,
that,
yes.
That has been converted, that has some piping.
Yes, yes.
A big percentage of that.
What is the population?
I believe it's 500.
It's supposed to house, but we only have about 560 in there. 550 in there.
And Amy, this is the last elementary that really is missing a lot of the spaces that we just expected our other schools. Conference space, resource rooms, family resource center location, like all of those larger spaces that we've just grown more accustomed to utilizing aren't in existence in this building. So it's our final one to really get back to that.
Related to that, another thing they had issues with are the cafeteria here, and that's on your district facility plan to add to the cafeteria, because based on the needs for the school now, it's much too small. I know they said they have a breakfast program, and all of the kids have to line up outside of the cafeteria, and sometimes the line's too long, they don't get their breakfast, and, you know, we don't want that. We don't want that to happen. Also, they mentioned a behavioral issue with the kids have to enter back into the cafeteria line behind the wall, which poses a problem because they said a lot of the behavioral issues take place back there, and the cafeteria staff have to try and take care of that. That's obviously also an issue. And I know they mentioned, too, this is the bus entrance here, and they kind of mentioned another security issue here with the windows facing. Also, another issue with the green in general, that was kind of the more medium priority, that was more that the improved space planning is needed. And I mean, generally, this could apply to the entire school. I know the classrooms in general kind of are divided in a way maybe that isn't the best based on what everyone said. That could be improved. I know they said the art room, that teacher is an award-winning teacher, you know, and they want more space in there. It's crowded, you know, art takes a lot of supplies. Their kiln was in the middle of the room. That was tough for them. Let's see. The gymnasium, I know they said that the bleachers come out to half court, so they can't use them during games, which is an issue. They said the music room did enter into the stage, which was great because, you know, for plays and such, entering to the stage is a good thing to have. I know also that these bathrooms here for the children, they had to take the doors off, which they said they'd like them to be open just because it helps them, you know, watch the kids. It's a better thing to do. But the issue is that the hand push dryer is against the wall, so it's disturbing these classrooms. So my guess is that that's happening there as well. There's these special education classrooms, and I know that when we walked in here, there was an issue, I think, because there are some students with some behavioral issues also being housed in the same space as the special education, which is a distraction to both of those portions of students. So I think that's covered a lot of what we wanted to point out, but probably one of the low priority things here are the kind of corridors between classrooms, and I know a few people mentioned that could be a potential security risk too, because, or a distraction if you have a child misbehaving, you know, they're connected to this classroom, it's disrupting the other classroom in session, you know, there are also windows into these classrooms from the hallway that could pose a problem as well. And we've worked with a lot of school districts that have, you know, the same kind of issues, and we know what it's like to, we've seen from students and staff and teachers, you know, that it's really tough to focus on learning and teaching when you've got a school that doesn't fit your needs. You know, you want to be focused on teaching and learning and not have to worry about the distractions of a building that just doesn't work for you.
I want to talk a little bit about the site, and tell me if we're running out of time, please. I took a moment. We drove around the site, looked at the property. We did an aerial view of it, tried to get to know the architecture of the building. It's bones. It's engineering component side of it. You've got a lot of roof area. The good news is your facility plan, I think, was well written. There's a lot of good information on there that gives you flexibility. You're not tied down. The language is very broad. That's great. I think one of the things that I would suggest to the board, one of the things that we would come and promote as we make these adjustments to your plan is to think about the HVAC as it relates to the roofscape. You've got a large shingled roof. You have trusses in there. We've got to find out the exact placement of the insulation. One of the things that's happening these days with makeup air, fresh air machines, is they're being fitted up with filters with ultraviolet light, bipolar ionization scrubbers for the air. We want to make sure you get appropriate space for that. And I think there's a way to claim that within this roofscape and make that work for you. So as we're making these decisions, we'll help you manage that stuff. I'm actually kind of looking forward to that, to getting into the envelope, because the cost of energy for this building may go up slightly because we're having to put fresh air machines in. Right, but at the same time, we're going to bring it down because we're going to look at the envelope as a whole and where the insulation is placed. And we'll get the opportunity to put new LED fixtures in this building, right? We'll bring some costs down on that. So we're going to look at this globally to help you. When we looked at the site, we know that we got the middle school right next door. So all these decisions that we make, if we make any adjustments to the entry and how we bring kids in, I always tell boards of education that security starts when you approach the campus. It's not just at the front door. So we would take a look at how that entrance happens, if we want to skew that or pull that off, or if we, you know, is that location really the best? So we can look outside your facility plan, too, to make sure that's working. And I know that there's some criticism levied against the school about how the cars and buses approach and could that be improved, and I think it can be. But we really need to have a heart-to-heart talk about where you want kids coming in, where you don't want them coming in, and make sure we make the best decision for that. So I think we've talked a lot, but I think we've done a good analysis of your school, but we really haven't brought any design solutions to you tonight. We want to be careful about that. We know it's a limited amount of time and want to keep focused, but that's kind of it. I want to say thank you very much. We appreciate being here, and hopefully we get the chance to work with your district. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you.
It's not on our website, but we consider ourselves a studio. It's an open office, and the virus has affected us, like it's affected everybody too, so we've had to change some of our work behaviors, but we're very much a studio. We share a lot of our workflow. We don't have departments and cubbies where people and information kind of sit and reside. We share all that. I think we work as a team really well. We have appropriate meetings weekly so we know what's going on. Even though you would get me as the lead manager on the job, you would also get a senior staff member like Chris Wilson assigned to this. He's in the book. And you'd get Lindsay. And one of the things that I think we bring to the table that some other firms may not is we have Lindsay. And Lindsay's really good with helping me stay focused as an architect because she brings these other things to the table. And I think you get good service.
I would say that I think we're very flexible and adaptable, and things change so often, you know, things always arise, and I think that we're very good about, you know, not seeing it as adversity, but taking it as an opportunity. So I think that's what I would say.
Thank you.
into the parking lot?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Part of construction going down the steps down into the parking lot.
Yes.
It got
yes.
hit and they're having to replace that.
Okay. Okay.
There's always been one there. It's kind of gone now.
Thank you.
And I'm glad he knew what you were talking about.
That's on the punch list.
Okay. Well, we just decided if you were carrying a bunch of things, you could easily just.
Are you talking the side door?
The door we went in, yeah.
From the top drive beside it. Down into the lower parking lot where everybody parks.
Oh, okay.
There are like a set of four steps, five steps.
Yes.
You just drop down.
Yeah.
You see where the holes are there? You got
run and jump.
It got clipped.
That'd be great.
So the next group that we have here with us is Bob Belter and Sam Carr. This is David Samikar. This is Mike
Adipa.
And this is Gregory Smorstadt. And I'm just going to hand this over to them. Samikar, president of Clotfeld Samikar Architects, have Mike Adipa with me and Greg Smorstadt. Glad to be back in front of the board again. It's been probably about 15 years since we did the JCTC project, so love the opportunity to once again work with Jessamine County Schools. Just some personal information about me. I'm in my 45th year with Clotfeld Samikar. Mostly educational projects during that time. A number of renovation projects I've done are just countless, almost. It's what we do. Mike has been with us about a little over 22 years. He'd be serving as my project manager. Greg Smorstadt is here representing Banks Engineering, local engineering company. Greg's a landscape architect. He actually did his internship with us several years ago, worked about 10 years with us. And so he's been with Banks now a little over 2 years. So we figured we'd get some local people involved if we're fortunate enough to get you work. I want to talk a little bit. Again, 10 minutes is kind of quick, so we're going to go through some things that we found out, I guess, Friday afternoon. I should do this. I don't know. That the project involved a cafeteria expansion. We're also looking at potentially some renovation in the media center, as I understand it. And so one of the first things we were really looking at is the potential of where can you expand the cafeteria on that site. First thought was, well, you can actually repurpose a couple of the special ed rooms, build a couple of classrooms over here, get those complete before you actually start the renovation there, so you have some place to move those kids, and then expand within the existing footprint of the building. But we started also talking with Jason about the traffic flow issues that currently exist on site. And so we started then looking at what are some other possibilities that might present in terms of how we would approach the project if you were to actually expand the cafeteria out toward where the bus loop currently is. So again, over the weekend, mostly this morning, we started looking with Mike over some issues that we had with the
potential areas of traffic flow and how we could completely separate bus traffic from parent pickup traffic. So, Mike, I'll let you kind of explain the process that we went through on that.
Okay, well, thank you, Ray. What we did is with the, you're landlocked here with the road that came through here for in addition to the cafeteria. So, as Dave was saying, our solution would be to take over this area, but what we looked at here is, what if we brought it out into where that road was, and then we created a student entrance location here that would allow us to have parent drop off at this location, buses would come along this way, and all the students would come into an entrance lobby at this location. That would mean that the cafeteria could work as overflow for all that as well, and this allows you to have, I know in the current situation with COVID, stuff like that, you have temperature checks, you have things you might need to do to quarantine kids or in the spaces before they go into the building. So this gives us a large space to accommodate that as well, a flu season, whatever might come about in the future. So we're looking at that as a possibility. And then that would give us the total separation of buses is in yellow. The cars will be in blue. And, you know, we work some grading in here to make all this work. This would allow us to create a loop in circulation. And Greg will pick up here and talk about the circulation of the site.
Thank you, Mike. So a couple of the main things that we tried to do, like Mike and David said, was the main one of the main things was to separate the bus traffic from the car traffic. So the second thing we wanted to make sure we did was get as many cars off of 29 as we could and into the site to just kind of alleviate the congestion that happens up there, particularly in the morning. Being just down the street, as I'm sure most of you all are, travel this road all the time, it can be awfully backed up in the morning. So the thought would be to add a parent stacking loop down this side of Rosenwald to where when the cars would pull in, they could come and stack down here until they are ready to be dropped off. And this configuration could work for both the elementary school and the middle school, especially if they are staggered at like an hour difference start time. So something like that could work, drop off here for the elementary school and then do the exact same in everybody enter, come down and drop off on this side for the middle school. So we really feel like that would help alleviate a lot of the congestion that's out on the site.
One of the other things that we also looked at was the notion that when cars get backed up and stacked up, that you'd still have an ability to get into this parking lot at the elementary school. So having the crossover at this point in time would allow people to leave this parking lot even while cars are stacked at that location. Other thing I did, failed to mention, I realize you're gonna, as a district, moving to geothermal systems for your HVAC systems. Back in 1991, I was the first person that was instrumental in getting geothermal systems approved for schools in Kentucky with the Department of Education. I actually had to rewrite their front end to make that happen. So at that time, Mark Riles was the director, and he said, can we do this? And so we were able to get that in there. Also, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the direct purchase order option now for general contractors. Again, went to Mark Riles, said, can we do this? And he said, if you can get an answer out of the revenue cabinet, took me 3 days. I had it in writing, and that was in 2003, I believe it was. And so it's just something that has caught on nationwide. We do all the paperwork for you, other than we ask the finance officer to give us a series of purchase order numbers. But after that, we handle all the paperwork and do everything, and you simply write the checks for it. So, we've lost track of it at this point in time, but millions and millions of dollars for school districts by going with that method. Availability, I'm available right now. I'd be the person you see at your board meetings, at your progress meetings. I just came off of the Great Crossing High School project over in Scott County. I think maybe a lot of people, seems it's got a lot of press recently. I don't know if you've seen the new commercial for, I think it's Kentucky Farm Bureau with Benny Snell. That's at the athletic complex at that facility as well. So we're quite proud of that. So I guess we'll open it up, any answer any questions that you might have at this point. Hopefully we kept it within our 10 minutes. We have gone into a lot of specific detail. I realize you'd probably coming out of the cafeteria, you'd probably have some steps coming down as well, handicap ramp. That right in this area, it has been artificially built up already. So the car traffic can handle the slope a little easier than the bus traffic, but on the back half of it, it's not quite as steep anyway. So, it, great question.
Confident that we would be able to come up with a solution we need for that area.
Any other questions? All right, thank you guys.
Well, I'll ask one.
Okay. Sure.
Closer, can you tell me what you feel like makes you guys stand apart from maybe some of the other architects?
Creativity. I mean, just problem solvers. You know, I see a problem. I like, why can't we do purchase order breakouts with a general contractor? And I researched it, didn't see any reason why from a legal standpoint we couldn't do it. I said, let's do this. I looked at geothermal at a conference in 1990 over in Bardstown, Kentucky. They had a little cooler with a little geothermal loop into a water cooler. And he said, this is how it works. Turn it on this way, water got hot, put it on there, switched it, water got cold. That's too simple. That will work. And so then we had to get with East Kentucky Power, a lot of people involved with the Department of Education, Water Furnace International, and we got them to allow us to put the first geothermal system in the state. The other thing that stands out is you probably will not have another architect come here that has been bitten by a monkey that was owned by the person who this building is named after.
This building.
Pete
owned a monkey?
Pete Roy, 54 years ago. I was feeding a
turn the clock off. Turn the clock off.
I was feeding a monkey over at Bluegrass at that RECC, and he had a monkey. And I was trying to feed a grasshopper, and it thought it was here, and it bit me right there. And so how did I end up over there? Well, Pete's brother, Gene Royce, was a good friend of my dad, because my dad was with REA. He was the field rep for Kentucky. So they knew each other. So that's how I ended up over there, which also then led to East Kentucky Power inviting me to the conference where I saw the geothermal loop. So it all kind of ties together.
Comes full circle.
Yeah. Anybody
new? Full circle. Yeah. And I noticed, I'm sorry, I have to ask this question. Do you have a dentist in your family tree?
I do. He was my second cousin twice removed, Herb Scribner.
Yeah. Yeah. Head office on East Main Street.
He did. I still.
He was my dentist for.
It's funny, I actually go to the dentist in that building that he built that's right on Kentucky Avenue and Main Street. And we always used to walk by his office. I'm like, why aren't we going in that building? Because we were going upstairs to Dr. Hill. Yeah. Small world.
Small world.
Very small.
And I'll just add one more thing. Just by bringing banks on the team, you know, like I said, we are local. We are right up the street on Jessamine Station. You know, I have myself three kids that will be at Rosemore and the middle school. And probably over 50% of our office, we all have kids throughout Jessamine County School. So we are local. We have invested, you know, interest in what happens here. So that also might make a statement.
I'm a property owner in Jessamine County, as well as David Vickers, which is on one of our other project managers, is also a resident of Jessamine County as well. So we're local, we care.
And Greg's replacement intern, landscape in our office, Andy Louder, went through both of those schools. So, anyway, we'd love to work with you guys again. Absolutely.
Thank you all.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you guys.
Can we text David right now?
I want to verify.
Tell us when you're ready, Fred.
Oh, you really don't need to get that close.
Yeah, okay.
So I'm going to introduce our next person. It's Margie Jacobs. All of you should know her. She's with Tay-Tale Jacobs. And I'm going to go ahead and pass out all of her flyers to you guys and let her take the mic. You want her to hold it?
Just leave it there. I'm pretty sure I don't need it. If anybody has any trouble hearing me, you just let me know. But throughout my entire life, nobody ever accused me of not being able to project my voice. I think as a young student, I was probably told to stop talking more than I was told to speak up. Anyway, thanks for the invitation to present Tay-Tale Jacobs Architects qualifications to provide design services for the 30-year renovation projects at Rosenwald Dunbar and West Jessamine Middle. I believe our firm is the best qualified architect for these projects for many reasons, some of which include our firm has successfully completed 30-year renovation projects at Brookside, Gel, Nicholasville, and Warner. Our firm has worked with Jessamine County School Board on updating the district facility plan for the past 15 years. This process affords us familiarity with all schools in Jessamine County. Our firm has been working continuously with the board since 2004. We have observed and participated in evolution of changes that are necessary to sustain excellence. I personally have had the genuine pleasure and distinct honor to serve the board in the capacity of principal in charge and project manager on all projects completed by our firm since 2004. My service has given me 15 years of knowledge and understanding of district design preferences. This is a primary ingredient to ensure commonality and equity among school facilities. Our ability to hit the ground running allows us to build on lessons learned from current and past projects. As you know, we began actively planning for the career and technology renovations and new construction in the fall of 2017. That was 3 years ago. We spent approximately 18 months in the planning phase of this project, which includes work at East Jessamine, West Jessamine, and JCTC. Construction began in April of 2019 and is currently contracted to complete in the fall of 2021. However, because of many factors, work is well ahead of schedule and is anticipated to complete approximately 6 months early. As a contrast, the 30-year renovation project at Rosenwald Dunbar is scheduled to begin in the next 30 days. The planning phase is scheduled to last approximately 6 months, and construction is scheduled to complete by summer of 2022. That's a pretty aggressive schedule, but we know it's adequate because we've done it before at Brookside, Nicholasville, and Warner. If you refer to the centerfold of the handout, you'll see an aerial view of Rosenwald Dunbar and West Middle. A color-coded legend gives you a quick understanding of the floor plan of the school. During a brief tour last week, Maggie Osborne shared a few of the school staff and administrator concerns. We started in the media center, where Maggie directed attention to security concerns related to large expanses of exterior clear glass visible from the main entrance of the school, as well as limited space available to accommodate many programs that operate from the media center, including robotics. We toured the art room, where Maggie directed attention to the kiln in the middle of the room. If you look really closely in there, you'll be able to find the kiln in there amongst all the other art materials. So storage of art materials and a dedicated space for the kiln are priorities. And I can tell you, as I worked on those three schools, that Brookside, Nicholasville, and Warner had dedicated kiln rooms constructed during their 30-year renovation. Maggie also informed us that several classrooms have been adapted for special programs geared toward unique purposes. We generally refer to these as resource rooms. There's a high demand for these types of spaces at Rosenwald. Maggie expressed how much they love the relationship of the music room, stage, and gym to one another, but was quick to point out the encroachment of the bleachers into the basketball court prevent them from hosting community events and ball clubs. We stopped in the cafeteria that needs to be bigger. Maggie pointed out a small room labeled as individual learning, which was originally designed to be custodial closet and electrical, that's currently being used for individual learning space for lack of any other place for that program to occur. We also learned that supervision risks created by the configuration, both security and supervision risks, created by the configuration of storage workroom areas that are common to all the classrooms have now outweighed the benefits of that configuration when it was first constructed. From my perspective, a 30-year school renovation can be distilled down into five primary areas. They are safety and security, ADA and building code compliance, program flexibility, constructability and phasing, and daylighting and energy efficiency. Examples of that, safety and security, the interconnection of the classrooms through that storage and work area creates a problem during school lockdowns. Who's in charge? What if one classroom is out while the other classroom is in? If you can get in that door from the other classroom, you immediately have access to the adjacent room. And the visual separation from the student cubbies to the classroom. Denise, you've been a teacher, right? Yeah, so being able just to have your eyes on your kids at all times is paramount. And so 30 years ago, it was a great idea. These things change. And so they've decided at this point those concerns outweigh the nicety of having that little kind of enclosed space. Also, as you're well aware, within the last 10 years, the extensive use of clear exterior glass below eye level. I mean, I want us all to remember that. I mean, that's the priority. We do not want to lose daylighting in our schools. But we do want to be conscious of placement of clear glass around the perimeter of a school. It's sad, but I think it is a reality. And then another safety concern is lack of a kiln room. ADA and building code compliance examples. The door hardware at Rosenwald Dunbar does not comply with ADA requirements. They need to be levers instead of knobs. The cafeteria doesn't comply with building code egress requirements. While there are two exits, the two exits are not remote, are not far enough apart, which creates a hazard. The program and flexibility issues are the issues that the staff and administrators are going to talk most about. And that's, we will rely most heavily on our communications with the staff with regard to that, defining where we need to improve those program spaces. What they're not going to be thinking about, but what your administrators, particularly those who are currently involved in the projects over at East and West and JCTC, know that during the design process, we've got to be thinking about constructability and phasing. We've got to be thinking about how we're going to keep the construction zone clearly separate and segregated from the operations zone. And it's one thing to do that at high schools with students that are a little more cognizant of their space, but with little kids, and the curiosity, it becomes even more important at the elementary level. And then also daylighting and energy efficiency. Those are very tangible issues that translate into dollars. And those dollars translate back to you in general funds that you're not spending on something else. So that's very important to us. Additionally, during the design process, it falls to the architect to make sure the scope of the renovation and new construction work can be executed safely and efficiently. With respect to the construction issues, I feel like there are three primary issues. Once again, safety and security. Safety and security always trumps everything else. So maintaining those clear separation zones, phasing, designing a construction plan that minimizes the number of times you have to move your students and your teachers. That's paramount. And when you do move them, it needs to occur during natural breaks, your winter break and your summer break. And then occupancy during construction, which is the third number one priority, is to make sure heating, cooling, ventilation, fire suppression, plumbing, power, lighting, fire alarm, intercom, bell, clock, phone, and data systems, I mean, they go on and on forever, have to remain operational in all the occupied areas. And that seems like a simple thing, but in a renovation where you're cutting into the systems and making sure that it doesn't snowball over here, that's not always easy. So that becomes very important. In my opening statement, I referenced our firm's knowledge and understanding of all the schools of Jessamine County. If you refer to the back page of your handout, you will find an educational program comparisons between each of your six elementary schools. For example, we know from KDE's perspective, the only programmatic deficiency at Rosenwald is the size of the cafeteria. The recommended size of a cafeteria for elementary schools with 600 students is 4,600 square feet. Rosenwald is 2,570. This is reflected by the orange box under the chart RDES, that orange box there. Additionally, the areas shown in lavender represent program areas at Rosenwald, which although they are not considered deficient by KDE standards, they're smaller than other elementary schools in the district. And the area that jumps out most to me is the allowance for site-based decision making programs. And that is the SBDM is the box that says 590. Katie, anything that doesn't fit, frankly, anything that doesn't fit in the other program
spaces
areas
that the other schools have that aren't necessarily
yes
restricted, and, but they're additions.
Yes, and I would say to the board that a case could be made that if we were more equitable, keep in mind, when these calculations are done, a lot of judgment goes into it. It's not always black and white. So I would say to you, a case could be made that in order to show a more equitable amount of site-based decision-making, you might say, well, Rosenwald really doesn't have the capacity for 600. It's really, with when we compare it equitably, with our other elementary schools, it might be more appropriate to say that it's two classrooms less or one classroom less to put that space into your site-based decision-making. Do you see the kind of rationale for that? And so that's what I say, you know, these things are not, and when I work with the facility plan, I'm always careful to say that my job, the job of your architect during those district facility plans, is to be the bean counter. It's up to the district to understand what's important to the district and what are the minimum requirements for the district. Jessamine County does better than the minimum. They always have. So, you know, that's where I would say, so I'll take the blame. I probably should have been a little more thoughtful about the way I place those things. Anyway, so that's one of the things we know. I think the other thing to look at, too, for me, as I was studying it in the context of Rosenwald, is just to go down and look in those blue, that blue line of the total gross area, and you will see that Rosenwald is one of the two smallest of your elementary schools, the smallest being Brookside. But I would point out that we're only showing a capacity of 562, not 600, for Brookside. So, I mean, I do think that this kind of information is very important and relevant when you're taking on a 30-year renovation for a school, because I think equity to all of us, I think we would all agree that equity is important to us. In an effort to keep the presentation brief, I'd like to close by emphasizing three reasons that make our firm the best choice for this project. Our extensive experience in school renovation, including 15 years of successful working relationship with Jessamine County Board, and more than 35 years working with the Kentucky Department of Education. Over 45 years of working closely with contractors of various skill sets. Our commitment to work with construction workers in a manner of mutual respect and trust allows our team to obtain the best quality of work in the shortest time possible. Lastly, and most important, our focus on advocacy for Jessamine County schools throughout all phases of the work make us the best choice. Thank you.
She did.
I know. She cut you off.
She kind of started that way.
She's been out there watching the live stream. Thank you, Margie.
Thank you. Okay, so shall I just go right on into a construction report?
You
want to
give an update on the CTE since she's here?
That would make sense.
And then would you like to pass them around since I don't have a face covering on? Yeah, I hope you all noticed this kind of new photograph on this, and I loved it so much I had to put it on here again, even bigger. I walked in last Friday to West Jessamine High School as they were handing out books and greeting parents. They had tables set up at the top of the landing where they were greeting and assisting kids and families. I just got goosebumps. I really did. So anyway, we're thrilled about that. And I can keep this pretty brief too. Over at East Jessamine High School, every room is occupied by their teacher, with the exception of the renovated science room. We are waiting on some wall cabinets. And I can't say for a fact that the teacher's not in there, because everything else is up and running, but we do have some wall cabinets to get installed there. At West Jessamine High School, the CTE addition is up and running and occupied. The kitchen is up and running and functional. The administrative offices, I think, have been exceptionally well received. And as you can see, the new security vestibule is a real highlight to that project. And at JCTC, the only thing that they have not completed is renovation of the shack. It's my understanding, which is their concession stand, if you all are not familiar. Snack Shack. And that's scheduled to complete in 2 weeks. But keep in mind, we're not finished at JCTC. We're only finished at the current time until we can complete renovation of the 1959 area so that we can move. It's that shell game again, so that we can move classes, the ag classes from over at JCTC into those, and then we'll complete the renovation at JCTC. Any question? Oh, I've been remiss. I do request the board's approval of three change orders. Change order number 12 includes two items, the Department of Transportation requirements, additional requirements for work in the right-of-way. That cost is $3,195, and that portion of this change order is reimbursable through the state. The Department of Transportation will refund the board. And then we were required by the Kentucky Building Code to provide six new fire alarm devices in the GMPE locker rooms. So the total amount for that change order is $7,495.15. Change order 13 is divided into two because it involves a direct purchase order with Atlas Enterprises. It includes a myriad of changes with the net add of $170.10. If there are any individual questions, any questions on any one of those individual items, I'll be happy to answer it. Thank you.
We're going to go ahead and invite you up to give us an update of where we are now, especially in relation to where we were when we saw you 3 weeks ago.
Well, it's a little bit better news this time.
It was 3 weeks ago.
A good way to start.
But thanks for the opportunity to come and update you on the status of COVID in Jessamine County. As of today at 2 o'clock, we have a total of 412 positive cases to date, with 34 of those currently active and 378 recovered. And most importantly, no deaths up to this point in Jessamine County. So we're still, you know, one of the few counties left that haven't actually had any deaths reported. So that's great news. We're trending in a positive direction based upon our rolling 14-day weekly average, reducing from 57 on August the 2nd to 32.5 on August the 23rd. So that's a significant reduction when we're looking at that 14-day weekly average. We had a significant reduction from August the 9th to August the 16th, but peaked back up some last week. We went down to about 29 cases the week before last, but went back up to about 35 last week. So we saw about a 6 or 7 case increase, excuse me, last week. We're currently listed as community spread status, which community spread status means that you have over 1 but less than 10 per 100,000 in population cases per day. And that's on the Department for Public Health's 7-day average daily incidence rate by county. We were listed as accelerated spread, which is over 10 and less than 25 per 100,000 in the weeks ending July the 19th, July the 26th, August the 2nd, and August the 9th. And obviously that's when, you know, we were presenting to you last time. We were really at a peak level at that point in time. So we've seen some improvement since then. The average incident rate for Kentucky is 10.72 daily cases, and our rate for the week ending August the 23rd is 9.52. So we're a little bit lower than what that average is in the state of Kentucky. And like you see, at 9.52, that puts us in that community spread status instead of that accelerated spread status. Our testing demand at the Jessamine County Health Department has actually slowed over the last 3 weeks, with our most recent week having a test positivity rate of 3.21%. Now, that compares to Kentucky's overall test positivity rate, which was reported today at 4.77%. And if you'll remember, we actually went above 6% in the state of Kentucky for positivity rate at one point in time. So the state of Kentucky has actually seen their positivity rate come down as well. Their actual testing demand is plateaued. It's you know, it's still increasing a little bit. They're doing about the same amount of testing across the state, even though ours is declining a little bit. Okay, so that's important to remember as well. So even though their test positivity is declining and decreasing statewide, they're still doing the same amount of testing. So that's really an important point. We're limited, really, in the ability to specifically define our test positivity rate, because when we present test positivity rate for our county, that's just based upon our individual testing. That's not based upon all the other facilities and providers that are doing testing in Jessamine County, because we don't get those reported to us. They don't have a requirement or a responsibility to report those particular tests to us, especially the negative test. The only thing that we would have reported would be a positive test case that was a Jessamine County resident that actually come to us. So we have to remember that when we're reporting our test positivity rate, that can fluctuate some. You know, and we always want to kind of compare that to the state's positivity rate. And knowing that our cases have kind of been on the decline for the last few weeks, but the state of Kentucky's has plateaued, kind of makes sense that our positivity test rate would probably be a little bit lower than what Kentucky's is at this current point in time. You know, but the one thing that we do need to remember is how quickly that this status can change, just like we saw July the 19th, how we shot up very quickly, you know, for about 4 weeks in a row until we started, you know, gliding back down a little bit. So we don't need to become complacent. You know, we need to stay active in doing and being diligent with the things that we can control, such as the social distancing, the masking, you know, continuing to encourage the community to do those things in particular, for sure. And also the testing. You know, anybody that's experiencing symptoms should go get tested. You know, it's kind of what we've seen, I think, relative to the testing going down, is relative to folks have come back from traveling, right? They've kind of settled back into their routines a little bit, and they're not so concerned about their exposure to COVID. So I think that that's part of the reason that we've seen some decline in demand. You know, we saw a pretty good increase in demand at the points and times where we had cases jumping up and people become a little bit more concerned. So it's easy to become complacent, especially when people get tired, you know, of all of these requirements, all of these recommendations relative to COVID. So we need to make sure that we continue to be diligent as a community and as a county, you know, because that's the only way that we're going to keep businesses open. That's the only way that you're going to get school back to in-person and that you're going to be able to keep school in-person. That's the only way that you're going to be able to have athletic events, okay, because if we're not diligent and we start having cases, cases mean people are going to be isolated, people are going to be quarantined, you know, so it's going to interrupt, it's going to disrupt a lot of our, you know, normal daily life's routines. So let's all remember to stay diligent with that. You know, we also kind of keep an eye pretty closely on Fayette County as well, because we have a lot of our community that travel back and forth in and out of Fayette County. A lot of our folks that work in Fayette County shop, eat, play in Fayette County. So, you know, I continue to watch them pretty closely. And in regards to their incidence rate, last week, they actually went down just a little bit, and they went into the community spread as well, because they've been in accelerated spread like we had for weeks and weeks, okay? We've been out of accelerated spread into the community spread for a few weeks now. Well, they went down into the community spread, but just today, a new map showed that they were at 10.1. So they're kind of teetering on that community spread and accelerated spread. So that's why I say we need to be diligent. We don't need to be complacent, because that can happen to us very quickly as well. So we still have work to do. And, you know, I think that I feel much better about where we're at now than we were, you know, back on August the 2nd at that period in time. You know, but we still need to kind of continue to ensure that we're moving those average case rates per day at least below 5. You know, when we were below 5, and we were below 5 for about the first 16 weeks of our COVID mitigation phase. You know, so the first 16 weeks, we were below 5, and most of that time, we were actually below 3, you know, teetering between 1, 2, and 3, you know, which we didn't feel like that was a lot of activity that was occurring, and it was much easier for us to kind of maintain and to do our contact tracing and tracking that goes along with that. So we need to continue to work. Once we get below that 5, we won't feel like that we have as much community mitigation, okay, and it would give us a better opportunity to do containment that we need to do. Right now, it's more of a mitigation phase than it is the containment phase, because it's still very difficult to track with as much spread as we're having to date. So that's kind of where, you know, we want to target toward getting those case rates per day below the 5 and continue moving back down to the 1 to 3. If we could get back to where we were at, you know, that first 16 weeks, I'd feel pretty comfortable. I'd feel pretty happy where we were at. But at least the last few weeks, we've been on a positive trend downward. And I think that that's because, you know, folks are maybe taking a little bit more seriously the recommendations in regards to masking and social distancing, because they realize that's the only way that we're going to continue to operate as a community, and that we're going to be able to continue to move forward with businesses staying open, schools getting back to in-person instruction, athletics, you know, getting back on the fields and in the gyms, you know, to play and to participate. So that's what we have to continue to ask our community to do, is to be diligent doing their masking, doing their social distancing, and we have to continue to encourage, you know, because it is very easy to become complacent, you know, and forget those masking policies, forgetting those social distancing policies. And, you know, you as a school board, us as a health department, we have to be the leaders in that. You know, we definitely don't want to pull up our Facebook pages, you know, and seeing these leaders and seeing people that we know at, you know, surprise birthday parties. You know, nobody's masking and everybody's eating off of a buffet and enjoying themselves and drinking. We don't need to see any Facebook pictures like that, right? You know, and when we do, we need to have those, you know, diligent conversations with folks, you know, because that's not going to do us any good, and that's not sending a good message and setting a good example for our communities, because it's going to take us all doing the things that we're asked to do and being diligent in these preventative measures that we've been asked to do as well. So that's really all the information that I have for you as an update. I'm always welcome to take your questions, always welcome to receive your emails or your calls or whatever it might be, and I'll respond as quickly as I can.
Go ahead.
Well, the containment phase means that we're having less cases, okay? You know, right now in community spread, it's very difficult. And when you're in accelerated spread, you've got cases happening all over the board, and it's difficult to track, you know, those individual cases back one to another, okay? Once we get down below 5 and we get closer to that case rate of 1 per 100,000, that means that we have an opportunity, if we have 2 or 3 cases, they're probably going to be connected. And it's not happening out, you know, in the community, just here, there, and everywhere so much. So that's kind of the key. If the spread is happening and the transmission is happening more slowly, that means that we can work to contain it. We can get the people isolated. We can get the people quarantined that need to be quarantined that are probable to maybe contract the COVID virus because of their interaction that they had with the positive case. So that means that we contain it, okay, within those particular ramifications, instead of us not being able to understand who these people had contact with and where they maybe contracted it at the first place, and it just continues to spiral because individuals are not quarantined and individuals are still just jumping around the community and spreading it, especially since there's a probability that they're asymptomatic and they're not showing any symptoms at all, which we've seen about 60% of our folks have been asymptomatic relative to that. So, you know, that's why it's important to get to that containment aspect of it.
Anybody else? Randy, we appreciate it as all always.
Right, no problem.
You would put us on your calendar for next month, too. Thank you, sir.
He'll do call block on
that's right, I know.
That
he's
too,
gonna
early. Yeah. I just want to say again, I appreciate Randy's perspective. I think that he has driven home the point that this is a community-wide effort, and we've all got to try to make individual decisions to hopefully impact this greater cause or our desire to get back to in person. And I appreciate you driving that home. And then I also appreciate the fact that he's trying to help take us through the process to where we're doing it the right way, to where hopefully we don't transition back and forth as frequently frequently from the in-person to virtual and so on. So
absolutely,
I appreciate you very much.
Thank you, Randy. What's next, Mr. Moore?
Do we want to take a 5-minute?
You want to do a quick recess, or do we want to power through? You want to do a recess?
We could just
let's do a quick 5-minute. We'll recess at 7:41. Here at 7:48, and if they want to go ahead and play this.
And I sent you a link to our opening day celebration, but if you haven't seen it and want to see it, I can definitely resend it. But I just thought it would be really nice for some of our audience to get to see a little bit of the production, and we'll take, again, just a few moments and definitely want to capture our final student performance. But keep in mind, this event, our opening day celebration, is our kickoff for all of our staff. We have between 1,500 and 1,600 staff members that came together. We last year did it at Southland, and we weren't able to come together because of our safety protocol related to COVID-19. So we had all of our staff meeting on the campuses where they're employed and brought them together in smaller groups. But we did this as a united organization, and again, the whole purpose of it is to celebrate and welcome everybody back, but I want you guys to see a little bit of it. And then keep in mind as you're looking at this that the gentleman to my right is the producer of this. Yeah, this one all the way over here, not this one, this one all the way over here, Fred Lutzenberg, and he has done such a wonderful job. He did this last year, but probably one of the most common things that I'm hearing from everybody is they want to know who we hired. Because it looks so professional, and he truly did an outstanding job, so I appreciate it. Yeah. So if you could, go ahead and let it roll.
Dialogue. Okay, folks, that finishes my part of the program. I do want to leave you with a final thought. In these uncertain times, when things just really don't feel like they are what they seem to be, remember the 3 R's and do what you love. I don't care, so call me crazy. We can live in a world that we design. Cause every night I lie in bed, the brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me awake. I think of what the world could be, a vision of They can say we've lost our minds. I don't care if they call us crazy. Run away to a world that we designed. Every night I lie in bed, the brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me away.
Anything. Not that time. Okay. Not Patrice and Fred were. But I think is absolutely an achievement and a recognition, and that's the way we got to start our school year off. So I think it was heartfelt by our staff, and I just wanted you guys to get a sense of it too. But yeah, if you haven't already, I do encourage you to look at the entire thing, because it has a couple strong messages through it too. I would like to give you just a couple quick updates that I've decided to just put under the title of COVID updates. And first is we did get an additional 5 days of training for our staff, and I just wanted you guys to know that those training dates were utilized well. We spent all of last week and half of the week before making sure that our staff was trained for the virtual instruction, coming back, all of the safety protocol, and several other things, and felt like we utilized that time well. We also did exactly like you guys were recommending, and making sure that we were using that time to make connections with students. We've had the majority of our students we've been able to reach and give make those connections with, so that they understand what the expectations are for this Wednesday moving forward, and they have their points of contact. We also have utilized this time, and I know that you guys have participated, the board members have participated in some of this stuff personally, but we've had open houses, and we've had to do those things a lot different than we have in the past. They've been in small numbers, single numbers, small groups, but we've had a lot of open houses throughout the district, so that our families could make those connections again face-to-face with their teachers before the school year started. So all that's worked really well. We've distributed hundreds and hundreds of Chromebooks out, and we have an additional 900 on order, and we've had those on order for quite some time, and that's been delayed, but we're hopeful that we'll get those so that we can actually distribute out even more, hopefully by mid to late September. One other thing that you guys have had some conversations on, and I just want to give you a sense of where we are here, is with our student enrollment. We have had a larger number than previous years of families that have chosen to go the homeschool option, or withdraw from Jessamine County Schools. But if you look at our overall numbers, I anticipate that we'll see a higher enrollment than last year. I also am hopeful that we'll see some of those families that have made those decisions transition back to us as we progress through this pandemic. But I just wanted you guys to know that number, or know that we are sensing that we're going to have a larger enrollment than last year. And what we start doing as soon as Wednesday, and it will go through Tuesday of the following week, is what we call a warm body count. So we'll track the number of students that are showing up for our NTI and our Virtual Learning Academy, and I'll be able to give you a pretty accurate count on that enrollment. So, and the only other thing that I was going to report out COVID related was a return recommendation for athletics, and I was going to go ahead and save that since that's an action item.
Okay.
Are there any questions for me?
Okay, so that brings us to the consent portion of the agenda. We've got 17 items on the docket. Any questions, comments about any of those?
I read through all that, and not surprised, but I thought it was odd that you all were even questioned to start with, to be quite honest about it, but I'm glad it was very favorable, and it sounds like you had to go in great detail with every step you did. Yeah. So I appreciate that all things were found in good standing, every single thing. Yeah. So I appreciate that.
Yeah. Anything else? Okay. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Okay. to the action items. Number one is the KSB annual policy updates. This is the second reading.
There haven't been any changes from when we reviewed this last month, so it's my recommendation that you approve the changes that were outlined and recommended by the Kentucky School Board Association.
Do we have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Okay. We got a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Okay. Item number two.
Yes, this is revisions for Title IX regulations, and these are regulatory revisions, and it is my recommendation that we approve the Title IX changes and approve this through an emergency reading. And Michelle Gadberry can answer any specific questions you guys may have.
Through an emergency?
Yes, it's emergency reading, so this would be a one-time reading so that we can implement them more quickly than the 2 months.
They went into effect August 14th, and we just got the revisions at the end of July, so they need to be enacted in one reading.
Okay. Any questions? All right, I'll make a motion to approve. Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Opposed say no. Number three.
Yes, this is a resolution that is in line with what we're dealing with COVID-19, in the sense that it would be a short-term resolution that would allow us to offer to our staff additional emergency leave days, which you saw outlined in the document. Again, this is a resolution that would be in place for a short period of time, and it is my recommendation that you approve it.
Any questions?
This is in addition to, and I look at this as more of a short term. This is 10 days or less that we would utilize, and the other would be for a longer period of time.
And that's for all employees, correct?
Yes. Oh, okay. Certified and classified.
Gotcha.
Similar to the one that was enacted earlier for the previous school year, this is for the upcoming year.
Yes.
We have a motion to approve. Sorry, Denise, you making a motion to approve?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. All right, number four.
Yes, this is a change to the certified salary schedule. And one of the items is really to align itself with more of our practice. We've had a rank 4 salary schedule and a rank 3 salary schedule. Look at them now, it's the recommendation that they be the same. And the reason that we're doing that is because of the new guidance and flexibility that's been given to us by the Kentucky Department of Education through the Professional Standards Board to start bringing people back that maybe have left the profession and are coming back in an emergency status. So it gives us the ability, say somebody that taught for 12 years and is coming back, they can still get credit for those 12 years and are rewarding them. The emergency system used to not operate as flexible as it is now, so it gives us the ability to attract back people that maybe left the profession. And then the other part of that is the mental health behavior consultant. We realized that this was omitted from the salary schedule, actually because we haven't had it for some time. But if you guys recall, last year we received the state, individual school districts are now receiving additional money through Senate Bill 1 that has to go specifically to counselors, consultants, anyone in that range that are helping support students that have potential mental health challenges. So this is allowing us to utilize those funds. I believe we received $42,000. Is that $43,000? That, again, has to be money spent for this purpose. So we wanted to make sure we had that salary schedule and job description. So it's my recommendation that you approve both of these revisions to the certified salary schedule and put those in effect for July 1, 2020.
Any questions? We have a motion to approve.
Motion to approve G4.
I'll second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Okay, number five.
This is the coach's handbook, and we revise this each year. You probably had an opportunity to look at this and see the revisions, and they truly are more than anything related to overnight trips, which really is correcting some language to get it in line with our practices. I don't know if there are any questions, but it is my recommendation that we approve the handbook.
Motion to approve G5.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. All right. Change order, number six.
Yes, this is change order number eight, which is for the Providence School construction project, and it is an increase of $1,990, and this is for a required emergency lighting and fire alarm strobes. So it's my recommendation that you approve this sum for the change order number eight.
Approve number six. Second.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. All right.
The next three are the ones Margie did, right?
Yeah.
I believe.
Yes.
Any questions on those since we've already heard some about them?
No. Motion to approve G7.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no.
Motion to approve G8.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no.
Motion to approve G9.
Second.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. All right, number 10, Mr. Moore.
This is, you heard the three proposals this evening, and this is a request that you guys go ahead and approve the selection of one of these architects so that they can continue the work for the Providence School and West Jessamine. I'm sorry, for Rosenwald Dunbar and West Jessamine Middle School. We don't need to revise or renovate that one again.
Yeah. Okay.
And I don't know if you guys have any questions for Jason, Val, or me.
I think other than just which one, have you guys done in-depth interviews with all three? I mean, obviously, we just heard 10 or 12 minutes tonight, so.
Submitted proposals on Thursday of last week, and we reviewed them as a committee together on Friday. I went through all them, and then I checked on references with my peers around Central Kentucky to find out who they would recommend, and there was two that they had all worked with. One of them had some glaring reviews from Fayette County and from Woodford County, and I can tell you who they were recommending. It was Tatel Jacobs, was Margie. They saw, as far as the CA, the contractor administrator, she was the best that they had ever worked with in terms of renovations, because there's always unforeseen things that come up when you're renovating a building. And then we went through them and looked at past history and just the history that we've had with Margie. I mean, she's really pushed projects along. And just from my experience this past year, it's been good to see her leadership style in construction meetings, and how she's addressed issues with contractors and kind of held their feet to the fire.
I mean, I've only been on the board 20 months, but I can say that the interactions with Margie have been first rate. I mean, every time she's come in here, the project's moved along. There's not been hiccups, even the few times that there were unforeseen circumstances. You know, it was addressed pretty quickly, and yeah, mm-hmm. And that's no disrespect to the other two that presented tonight, obviously.
They're a step above.
You know, the other two tonight, I'm sure, do a fine job, but I think there's a degree of familiarity, obviously, with the way Margie operates. So is that the recommendation that we?
Yes, sir. It's my recommendation that we go with Tate Hill Jacobs Architects.
I'll make the motion to approve Tate Hill Jacobs Second. Architects. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed say no. All right. Now, number. Well, hang on. We've got one more. Item number 11, which is the one we added to the agenda tonight, is to hear the superintendent's. I didn't get to see it today. My understanding in talking with the superintendent is that the governor's heard the recommendations from KHSAA and is deferring to the local boards of education to determine how they move forward. Is that
yes.
accurate? Val? Matt? Okay. So I think we wanted to give Matt an opportunity to provide his recommendation on how he wants to proceed as we sit here on August the 24th, understanding that things could change dramatically, but we've got to kind of have a plan for right now.
Right. And I did meet with the athletic directors, Val, our health department, and then local health department, and then our director of health in the school district, and we kind of talked through several things. And I do think the next phase in this transition definitely will cause us to have to look at things a little bit differently with athletics, and with the biggest change being that our students are going to be in closer contact with one another. They'll be utilizing some of the same equipment, and then they'll be participating in activities that probably look more like the game situations or scrimmage situations, and then there will be larger cohorts. So what will be changing is, instead of, say, football practicing in groups of 10, maybe opportunities for them to practice 10 on 10 or 6 on 6 and be in more contact and potentially larger in size. But I do feel like as we went through everything, we can put protocols in place to address some of the safety concerns that were identified. We talked about things which we need to develop the guidelines for, but to include the number of people that would potentially be participating in games, transporting, the way that we would transport students to games, the expectations for sideline interaction, concession operations, and so on. So we've got some details to work out, but I feel like we can move in the direction of moving forward with the recommendations from the Kentucky High School Athletic Association. So it is my recommendation that the board approve Jessamine County Schools moving ahead with athletics. I do want to echo what Randy had said, though, because the thing that we don't want to happen is us to take two steps forward and then end up having to take one step backwards. And what I'm talking about there is making sure that every single person is playing their part to make sure that we're doing this as safely as possible. We are following the expectations out inside of school and outside of school to ensure that we're not increasing the likelihood that we're going to spread this virus. And no East-West game. Let's hope there's an East-West game. Yeah, so I'm glad you said that, Denise, because we have the practices that Jessamine County Schools has been applying, are that we're utilizing to guide our athletics. We're using for all activities to include extracurricular. So we have students that are performing in band, they're performing in chorus, and we are setting those same expectations. So as we're moving forward with athletics and these operations, we want to move forward in the same sense with our other extracurricular activities, as well as some of the things that may be going on with career and technical education. And the biggest difference that I'm seeing in the two is with athletics right now, we are talking about a much smaller group of students that would be coming together. And, you know, the language that's being utilized in the health profession are those cohorts. It'd be much more difficult to identify an entire school as a cohort and be able to operate as in the same way that you would with a group of 20 or 30 students. So, you know, while we have high school of 1,200, it would be hard to operate with those same type of guidelines that we would put in place for athletics. But the thing that I would also say on the backside of that, Denise, is, you know, when we transition back to in-person, we can't have athletics creating challenges also to where it doesn't allow in-person instruction to occur either. So, you know, we don't want those cases where we have spikes with teams that then transfer those challenges and concerns in the classroom. So everything that we can do to practice the safety procedures and protocol for our sports will be very relevant to what we're doing in the classroom.
If there's no other questions, I'll make a motion to approve the superintendent's recommendation to proceed with athletics in Jessamine County. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed say no. All right.
I didn't even say anything. I was wondering how many people were
going
to watch me.
All right. Do we have a motion to enter closed session? You're not doing it this time. I'll make a motion that we enter closed session.
Second.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Say no.
No.
I'm marking it as 5-0.
4-1. Mark it as 4-1.
Bobby didn't want to go to closed session.